Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Worlds 2 by Eric Flint. Narrated by Keith Sellon-Wright. Preface. The opening sentence of the preface I wrote for my first collection of short fiction was this one. As an author, I'm almost a pure novelist. Nothing has really changed in that self-assessment. The first anthology was titled Worlds, hence the title of this succeeding volume, Worlds 2, and it was published in February of 2009. 8 years have gone by since then, a period of time in which I have published 27 novels, 5 novellas or short novels, 1 novelette, 5 short stories. 27 novels and 11 of everything else put together. If I wanted to be really fussy about it, I could even claim I'd published 24 novels and only 2 novellas, because 3 of the pieces in that category, the stories 4 Days on the Danube, Sanctuary, and Scarface, were technically also novels. Officially, anything over 40,000 words is a novel. In the real world, though, that's preposterous. To get a story published as a standalone novel in today's F and SF market, it needs to be at least 70,000 words, unless it's YA, young adult, and a lot of publishers insist on an 80,000 or even 90,000 word minimum. A novelist I was, a novelist I am, and it seems pretty safe to assume that a novelist I will remain. That said, 3 short novels, 2 novellas, 1 novelette, and 5 short stories is actually a pretty respectable output in and of itself for an author. If you add them all up, the word count comes to around 225,000 words, which is about twice the length of an average novel. Oh, happy day! That meant I had enough material to do another anthology of short fiction, even if I am a grubby novelist. Of course, I had to persuade my publisher that the project was worth doing, but she was amenable. The first anthology didn't sell as well as my novels. Anthologies of short fiction rarely do in today's market, but its sales were at least respectable. So here we are. Worlds 2. Never let it be said that authors can't be just as unimaginative as anyone else. But if the title is a bit pedestrian, I don't believe the same is true of the stories themselves. I like each and every one of them. I liked them when I wrote them, in a few cases as far back as 30 years ago, thereabouts, and I still did when I assembled them for this volume. I hope you will as well. Eric Flint, March 2018. The Ring of Fire Series. The Austro-Hungarian Connection. Chapter 1. The Track. Vienna, Austria, October 1634. Fortunately, that part of Janos Drugath's mind that always remained calm and controlled, even in the fury of a battlefield, was still there to restrain his panic. Indeed, it found the panic itself unseemly.
"You are a Hungarian cavalry officer in the service of the Austrian Emperor,"
that part of his mind informed Janos sternly.
"A breed noted for its valor."
It was all Janos could do not to snarl,
"So what?"
aloud. He was not facing the familiar terrors of war.
"You are not even unaccustomed to this,"
the stern inner voice continued.
"You have ridden in automobiles before. In Grantville, several times, just a few months ago."
Janos's grip on the handrest of his door to the vehicle grew tighter still. He was sitting on what Americans called the passenger side of the automobile. They also sometimes referred to it as riding shotgun, he'd been told, a phrase that didn't seem to make any more sense than many of the uptimer's expressions. True, he had. 4 times, in fact, with 3 different operators. But first, those vehicles had been driven by Americans very familiar with their operation. All 3 of them filled with the sobriety of age to boot. not a young Austrian emperor whose personal acquaintance with automobiles was this one and no other. The cursed thing had just arrived in Vienna the month before, not long before Janosch himself returned from his inspection of the frontier forts facing the Turks. Second, two of the vehicles had been large and stately things, moving not much faster than a horse and stopping frequently, what the uptimers called buses. The third had been a pickup filled with people in the open area in the back, which moved not much faster than the buses. And the fourth had been large and roomy, almost the size of a proper coach if much lower built, whose operator had been an elderly woman. None of them had been a so-called sports car, driven by a maniacal downtime monarch. Nor had any of them been driven on a ridiculous oval-shaped course freshly prepared for the purpose at the command of the crazed king in question. Ferdinand called it a racetrack. The term was English and unfamiliar to Janosch, but his command of the language was almost fluent now, and he could easily determine its inner logic. Its frightening inner logic. The automobile skidded around another curve in the racetrack. The rear wheels lost their grip on the surface, just as Janosch had known carts to do on slippery cobblestones during a rain or in mud. But the carts had been moving slowly. Not at... His eyes locked on the speedometer and froze at the sight. 60 miles an hour. The phrase didn't have a precise meaning to Janosch, but he knew that was far faster than he'd ever seen an American drive such a contraption. And even at slow speeds, such a mishap could easily cause a sturdy downtime cart to break a wheel or axle. The slide continued. The vehicle now clearly out of control. Janosch clenched his teeth, his grip on the armrest as tight as he'd ever gripped a sword hilt or a lance on a battlefield. Under his breath, he began muttering the same prayer that he always muttered when a cavalry charge he was leading neared the enemy and his own death might be upon him, commending his soul to the Virgin's care. Ave Maria, gratia plena, Dominus tecum. Fortunately, the muttered words were covered up by Ferdinand's squeal of glee. Fortunately also, while Ferdinand might be portly, he was young and had good reflexes. He turned the round steering mechanism abruptly in the direction of the slide, oddly, and within seconds the vehicle had resumed its steady and straightforward course. They were still going at an insane speed, but at least the king now had the automobile back under control. And apparently they'd broken neither a wheel nor an axle. Ferdinand squealed his glee again.
Ha! He glanced at Janosch, grinning. I learned that trick from Sandolin. It's not like a horse-drawn carriage, you know. The worst thing you can do in a skid is apply the brakes. That means restraining the mechanical horses under the hood.
His right hand released the control mechanism, and his forefinger pointed to the smooth, dark blue metal expanse in front of the window.
That's the hood, by the way. It's hard to believe, but there are more than 200 mechanical horses in there.
To Dugrath's relief, the king had slowed the vehicle considerably. Ferdinand glanced at him again, still grinning.
Congratulations, Janosch! You're the first person who's ridden with me on the track who hasn't said a word. Screamed a word, usually, and in the case of my wife and sister, cursed me directly.
Drugeth tried to return the grin. The result, he suspected, was simply a rictus.
Perhaps they were not cavalry officers.
He managed to relinquish his grip on the armrest and slap his chest.
And Hungarian, too. We are a bold breed.
Ferdinand chuckled and, praise the saints, continued to let the automobile's speed decline.
The first, no, you are the only cavalry officer to ride with me. The second explanation, I'm afraid, doesn't withstand scrutiny. Your uncle, Pal Nadasdi, has ridden with me, and I can assure you the hisses and screeches of terror he produced were no less profound than any German's.
They were nearing the stable-like building that the king had ordered constructed at the center point of one of the two long stretches on the oval track, what Ferdinand called by the English term the straightaways, another expression that was unfamiliar to Janosch, but whose inner logic was clear enough. Three men were emerging from the very large and open double doors, holding some sort of tools and wearing peculiar one-piece garments. The distinctive clothing went by the English name of jumpsuits and would have been enough in themselves to identify the men. But Janosch had excellent eyesight and recognized them even at a distance. The one in the center was Ronald Sanderlin, Jr., the uptimer who'd sold the automobile to the Austrian king and had agreed to move to Vienna to maintain it for him. He'd brought his wife and two children with him, although Janosch didn't know their names. Drugeth estimated his age at being somewhere in the mid-30s, although such estimates were always tricky with Americans. You simply couldn't use the easy gauge of the condition of their teeth. The older man standing to Sanderlin's left was his uncle Robert, who went by the nickname of Bob. He was unmarried and seemed to be extremely taxidermic. At least, on admittedly short acquaintance, Janosch had never heard the man say a word in either German or English. The third man was the most interesting of the three, from Drugeth's viewpoint. His name was Andrew Jackson Sonny Fortney, Jr. He was also married and had also brought his wife and two children. He was supposed to be a close friend of Ron Sanderlin's. Plausible enough at first glance, since they were approximately the same age, and Sanderlin had insisted that he come along to Vienna as part of the deal, as he called it. There was even, from the Austrian standpoint, he'd argued, the additional benefit that Fortney had experience working with train steam engines, which was not true of either Sanderlin himself or his uncle. Sanderlin had been quite stubborn on the matter. István Janosi, Drugeth's agent, had finally agreed to include the third man in the bargain, but he'd sent a private message to Janosch warning him that Fortney might well be a spy for the United States of Europe. The man was known to have been visited on occasion by the USE's fiendishly capable spymaster Francisco Nasi, for one thing. And for another, despite Sanderlin's fervent insistence that Sonny Fortney was his good buddy, István had not been able to uncover any evidence that the two men had spent any time together prior to the summer of this year, which was to say, right about the time the Austrian proposal to the Sanderlins would have come to the attention of the USE's political authorities. The issue was of sufficient concern that Janosch had even raised it with the emperor himself the day after he arrived back in Vienna. But Ferdinand had dismissed the problem.
Let's be realistic, Janosch. There is no possible way to keep secret the fact that three Americans with mechanical experience were moving to Vienna, not to mention the two complete automobiles they brought with them. Ha! You should have seen the huge wagons and their teams when they lumbered into the city. They could barely fit in the streets, even after I ordered all obstructions removed.
The emperor drummed his fingers on the armrest of his chair for a moment and then shrugged.
The enemy was bound to fit a spy into the mix unless they were deaf, dumb, and blind. And if there's any evidence that either Michael Stearns or his Jewish spymaster are incompetent, it's been impossible to find. So be it. Vienna is full of spies. But now, in exchange for allowing another, we've gotten our first significant access to American technology. I can live with that, easily enough. At least this time, we probably know who the spy is to begin with. That'll make it easier to keep an eye on him.
Janosch had his doubts, but, technically speaking, although the USE and the Austro-Hungarian Empire were political enemies, the two nations were not actually at war. Furthermore, from what he could tell, he thought the USE's Prime Minister Stearns was trying to keep an open conflict from breaking out, at least for the moment. That would be almost impossible, of course, if, as everyone suspected would happen next year, the USE's Emperor Gustav Adolf launched a war of conquest on Saxony and Brandenburg. In that event, Austria would most likely join the conflict. For the time being, however, Stearns seemed content to let the death of Ferdinand II and the accession of his son to the Austrian throne serve as a reason to keep the peace. The new monarch's surprising decision to publicly renounce any claim to being the new Holy Roman Emperor and replace that with his new title of Emperor of Austria-Hungary had no doubt gone a long way toward that end. Contained within the formalities of the titles was the underlying reality that Austria realized the time it could directly control or try to control all of the Germanies was at an end. Ferdinand III's public renunciation of the title of Holy Roman Emperor meant for all practical purposes that the Holy Roman Empire itself was now a thing of the past. Henceforth, presumably, Austria's interests and ambitions would be directed toward the east and the south, not the north and the west. The Turks hadn't been pleased by that announcement, to say the least. But the enmity of the Ottoman Empire was more or less a given, no matter what Austria did. The Turks had plenty of spies in Vienna, too, which was the reason Ferdinand had sent Janos Drugeth on an inspection tour of the Balkan fortifications the day after he made the announcement, even though that had required Janos to be absent from the scene during the later stages of the technology transfer from Grantville that he had largely developed. The emperor's decision to send off one of his closest confidants on such a tour of the fortifications was a none-too-subtle way of letting the Turks know that Ferdinand realized they would be furious at his decision, and they could swallow it or not as they chose. The automobile was finally gliding to a stop just in front of the three American mechanics who stood waiting. From the placid looks on their faces, it seemed they hadn't been much impressed by the ability of Austria's new emperor to move faster on land than any monarch in this history of this universe. That was as good a way as any to distinguish uptime mechanics from downtime statesmen and soldiers, or downtime fishwives and farmers, for that matter. Anyone else who'd seen Ferdinand III racing around a track like that would know that a very different man sat on the Austrian throne from the former emperor these days. Assuming they hadn't figured it out already, which most of them would have by now. In the first 2 months of his reign, Ferdinand III had forcefully carried through a major realignment of his empire in ways that his stolid father would never have imagined. The old man was probably spinning in his grave, to use an American expression. First, he'd pressured his father, on his deathbed, no less, to rescind the Edict of Restitution. At one stroke, at least in the legal realm, ending the major source of conflict with the Protestants of Central Europe. Second, within a week of his father's death, he'd renounced the title of Holy Roman Emperor. That was something of a hollow formality, since he hadn't had the title anyway, and replaced it with the new imperial title. Third, and perhaps most important, he'd jettisoned his father's reluctance to even acknowledge the uptimer's technological superiority in favor of an aggressive policy of modernizing his realm. Ferdinand could move just as quickly on that front because, as the prince and heir, he'd set underway Drugeth's secret mission to Grantville. Secret, not simply from the enemy, but from his own father. Had Ferdinand II learned of it while he was still alive, he would have been even more furious than he was by his daughter Maria Anna's escapades. Displaying better manners than Janos had seen displayed by most Americans in Grantville, two of the uptime mechanics opened the doors for the vehicle's occupants. Ron Sanderlin on the Emperor's side, and his uncle on Drugeth's. "Nice recovery on that last turn, Your Majesty," said Ron as he helped Ferdinand out of the seat.
"It worked splendidly, just as you said."
The older Sanderlin said nothing, as usual, and other than opening the door, he made no effort to assist Janos out of the vehicle. which was a bit unfortunate, since the contraption's bizarrely low construction made getting out of the seat a lot more difficult than clambering down from a carriage or dismounting from a horse. It didn't help any that Janos felt shaky and stiff at the same time.
"Hungarian cavalry officer," he reminded himself.
He decided that a straightforward lunge was probably the best way to do the business. Somewhat to his surprise, that worked rather well. And now that he was on his feet, the properly stiff-legged stance of an officer in the presence of his monarch served nicely to keep his knees from wobbling. Ferdinand III, Grand Duke of Austria, King of Hungary, and now Emperor of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, planted his hands on his hips and gave the newly constructed racetrack a gaze of approval.
"You've a right, Ron," he announced. "We need to build up the banks of the track on the curves."
"Yep. Even at only 60 miles an hour, which is nothing for a 240Z, you almost spun out. Of course, it'll help a lot once we can replace that packed dirt with a solid surface. Tarmac, at least. Although concrete would be better." Ferdinand nodded.
"We can manage that, I think, given a bit of time. We'll need to build spectator stands also."
He turned to Janos, smiling widely.
"We'll call it the Vienna 500, I'm thinking. You watch. One of these days, it'll draw enough tourists to flood the city's coffers."
Janos Drugeth, Hungarian cavalry officer in the service of the Austrian Emperor, a bold and daring breed, no one denied it, wondered what the 500 part of that title meant. But he kept silent. He was afraid to ask. Chapter 2. The Emperor. A few hours later, in one of the Emperor's private salons, Janos felt a similar terror. A greater one than he'd felt on the racetrack, in truth, albeit not one that was immediately perilous. In the long run, though, what the new emperor was contemplating was likely to be far riskier than what he'd been doing a few hours earlier at the controls of an uptime vehicle.
"Driving,"
Janos recalled, was the term Ferdinand III and his American mechanics used to refer to that activity. They did not use the English term, just a derivative from the stout German equivalent verb fahren. In both languages, the verb had the additional connotation of half-forcing, half-cajoling someone or some animal to go somewhere they would not otherwise go. In the afternoon, a young, portly, physically quite unprepossessing monarch had driven an automobile with flair. Tonight, he was proposing to drive an empire with the same flair. Indeed, in the full scope of his half-made plans, perhaps a fourth of an entire continent. Slowly, Janos lowered the letter the emperor had asked him to read. The letter was a long one and had been jointly signed by Ferdinand's oldest sister, Maria Anna, and her new husband, Don Fernando. That was, had been, rather, since he seemed to have dropped the honorific Don, along with his former title of Cardinal Infante. He was the younger brother of the King of Spain and a member of the Spanish branch of the far-flung and powerful Habsburg family. Fernando I, King in the Netherlands, as he now styled himself, judging from the signature on the letter.
"Are you seriously considering this, Your Majesty?"
Drugeth asked quietly. He resisted the temptation to glance at the two other men in the room. Whatever else, Janos knew, he had to be able to react to his monarch in this situation without being influenced by the attitude of others.
"Quite seriously, Janos, be assured of that. Not that I feel bound by any of my sister and new brother-in-law's specific suggestions. They face a very different situation than I do over there in the Low Countries. And while my sister is an exceptionally well-educated and intelligent woman, and was raised here, in the nature of things, her knowledge of the Austrian Empire was limited in many respects, quite limited in some. She has no close knowledge of military affairs, for instance."
The new emperor chuckled a bit heavily.
"Of course, the same cannot be said of her new husband, who could legitimately lay claim to being the most accomplished military leader produced by the family in generations.
All that was true enough. Janosch had encountered Maria Anna and had been quite impressed by her forceful personality, as much the product of an acute mind as the self-confidence of a princess. What was even more true was that the situation in Austria and its possessions was quite different, radically different, from the one she now dealt with in her new domain. There were but two or three languages in her new kingdom, for instance, and not too distantly related at that. Whereas in the Austrian Empire, how many languages were spoken? And not by a handful of foreign emigres or small groups in isolated pockets, either, but by entire regions and by powerful persons. Janosch didn't actually know for sure. German and Italian, of course, Hungarian, a veritable host of Slavic dialects, three very different groups of languages with little similarities at all. Maria Anna and her new husband only had to deal with a few religious strains, to name another difference. Catholicism and two brands of Calvinism. Some Jews, almost no Lutherans. Whereas in the Austrian Empire, although they'd been largely driven underground by the harsh policies of Ferdinand's rigidly Catholic father, there still lurked every variety of Protestantism, Christians who adhered to the Greek Church, as many if not more Jews as there were in Holland, and should the full scope of the successor's plans come to fruition, a great number of Muslims as well.
"All of the Balkans," he asked, managing to keep any trace of quaver from his voice. "Constantinople, too," said the emperor flatly. "The Turks have had it long enough."
Privately, Janosch made a note to himself to try to limit the emperor's ambitions in that regard. He could see no real advantage to seizing the southern Balkans beyond seizing territory for the sake of it, especially given that the rest of the proposal was already so ambitious. Insanely ambitious, one could almost say. Ferdinand proposed to overturn centuries of Austrian custom, social institutions, and policies at the same time as he expanded Austrian power. The older one of the other two men in the room cleared his throat.
"I have read many of those same uptime history books, Your Majesty. I feel constrained to point out that, in essence, what you propose to do here in Austria is what another monarch in Russia would try to do at the end of this century."
"Yes, Peter the Great."
The man, Johann Jakob Kiesel, Count von Gotche, who had served the Austrian dynasty as its principal spymaster for decades, cleared his throat again.
"He failed, you know, in the long run, if not in his own time. His Romanov dynasty would be destroyed in 2 centuries, and in great part by the same forces he set loose."
The emperor nodded.
"I'm aware of that. But simply because he failed does not mean that we shall. We shall have many advantages he did not possess. And please show me any alternative, Jakob. Given that those same histories make quite clear the fate of our own Habsburg dynasty, we were also destroyed in that same conflagration they call the First World War."
Somewhere in Janosch Drugeth's mind, perhaps his soul, he could feel the decision tipping. Pulled toward the emperor by Ferdinand's unthinking use of the pronoun we, in a manner that made quite clear he was using it in the common form of a collective pronoun, rather than the royal we. Although he'd only read some of the uptime accounts of the future history of Russia, which were fairly sparse in any event, Janosch was quite sure that Peter the Great had never done any such thing. The Russian Tsar had tried to transform his realm without ever once contemplating the need to transform himself and his dynasty. That might be enough. Even if it weren't, Janosch could not gainsay the emperor's other point. Drugeth had studied exhaustively every American account he could find. Austria had many spies in Grantville, and good ones, so he was sure they'd found most of them, and the accounts of the fall of the Austro-Hungarian Empire and its likely causes were clear enough. insofar as anything was ever clear when it came to history. If they continued as they had been, they were surely doomed. Not in their own lifetimes, probably, but so what? If a man had no greater ambition than to go through his life satisfying his personal wants and desires, ignoring what might happen to his descendants, Janosch thought him to be a sorry sort of man, not to mention a Catholic in name only. The fourth man in the room put the thought to words.
"I think we have no choice, Father. Like you, I can see all of the pitfalls and perils in the Netherlander's proposal. But what choice do we have? And I will point out that if we have advantages that our counterparts in another universe did not have, we also have disadvantages."
A thin smile came to the face of Georg Bartholomäus Zwickel, the Count's stepson and official heir.
"They did not have to face Michael Stearns."
Stearns. Mentally, Janosch rolled the harsh-sounding English name on his tongue. A former coal miner now grown into a force that had struck Europe like Attila and the Huns 1,000 years earlier. In his impact, at least, if not in his methods. Janosch had seen him once, although only at a distance, on the streets of Grantville. The man had been laughing at some remark made by his companion, the president of the USE's State of Thuringia Franconia. That was Ed Piazza, whom Janosch had met briefly and in person in the course of a casual social affair. He had liked Piazza's friendly and unassuming manner, just as he liked the look on Stearns's face when he laughed, for that matter. Being fair, it was hard to imagine such a laugh ever issuing from the mouth of Attila. Maybe. He filed that possibility away. For the moment, and for the foreseeable future, Austria and the USE were enemies. While silence filled the room for a time, Drugeth went back to scrutinizing the letter. Very shrewd, many of those suggestions. Janosch wondered who had actually originated them. For all their undoubted intelligence, he didn't think Maria Anna and Fernando would have thought of some of them. Being born and raised in royal families also created limits. They had, must have, at least one advisor who was capable of seeing beyond those limits.
"You have my full support, Your Majesty," he said.
For the first time since he'd begun reading the letter, he looked directly at von Gotsche. The old man looked tired more than anything else. As well he might, given that he'd served Austria's dynasty faithfully and well for so long. And now, almost at the age of 70, he was being asked to undo much of what he had done. Privately, Janosch made another note. It was unrealistic to expect the Count to do more than maintain Austria's spy network. Indeed, it might even be dangerous to try to force him to do more. Fortunately, Count von Gotsche had long been grooming his stepson to take his place. Janosch got along quite well with Georg Bartholomäus, who was in his late 30s. Granted, their background and temperaments were quite different. For all his aptitude at the covert tasks Ferdinand had set him lately, Janosch was still a Hungarian cavalry officer in the way he approached things. A soldier, not a spy, where Zwickel took to his stepfather's trade as if he'd been born to it. Still, he and Zwickel should manage to work together easily enough. It might even be best to retire the Count formally. Janosch would raise that possibility with the Emperor in private at some later time. It would have to be done carefully, making sure that Johann Jakob was genuinely willing and did not resent being forced into retirement. Given the situation, there was probably no single individual who could do more damage to the dynasty should his allegiances sour. Kiesel knew almost everything. Having made his decision, however, Janosch was immediately confronted by his major and immediate quarrel with the proposal.
"So," Ferdinand III stated, clapping his hands together, "we agreed on the basic points, then? First, which I've already had done,
repudiate the Edict of Restitution so as to restore peace in our relations with our Protestant subjects. Second, retake Bohemia. Third, simultaneously, I should say, press forward with the technology transfer from the USE so we can begin the modernization of our economy and our army. Fourth, prepare for an inevitable war with the Turks. Finally, and most important of all, begins a process of drawing all of our peoples and classes into support for our cause. That will necessarily require the introduction of a great deal of popular participation in the Empire's political affairs, although we will strive to keep it under control.
That was at least one too many tasks, Janosch thought, and he knew for a certainty the one that he thought should be eliminated. For a moment he hesitated, then, bracing himself, spoke it aloud.
Your Majesty, I strongly advise you to seek peace with Wallenstein and the stabilization of the northern frontier, rather than trying to retake Bohemia. I believe Wallenstein has no further designs on our remaining territory and would agree to such an offer.
He was fudging a little there. Janosch was fairly certain that Wallenstein's ambitions lay to the east, not the south, true enough. But those same ambitions would almost require obtaining at least a part of Royal Hungary, or Wallenstein would have no way to reach the east. Not unless he was prepared to launch a war of conquest on the Polish heartland, at any rate, which Drugeth thought unlikely. He was willing to make the fudge, nonetheless, if he could keep the Emperor from such a rash and unwise policy. The truth was, so long as Wallenstein satisfied himself with seizing only the northern portions of Royal Hungary, Janosch didn't care. Those lands were mostly inhabited by Slavs, not Hungarians. From a military standpoint, they were more of a nuisance than anything else. True, there was an awkward personal matter involved. His own family's estates were mostly located in that very area. It would be a pity to lose the lovely Renaissance-style residence his father had built in Hormona. It was only 25 years old and had all the modern conveniences a man could wish for. But ceding a small portion of Austria's northernmost lands, even ones that included Hormona, was a small price to pay to get a stabilization of the northern borders. The Emperor would most likely find a way to compensate the Drugeth family for the loss, and what one architect had built, another could build as well. But even if the Emperor didn't, Janosch would still argue in favor of ceding the northern portions of Royal Hungary. Being of the aristocracy, the way Janosch viewed human relations bound a man to his duties far more than to his privileges. What overrode all other considerations, certainly mere personal ones, was that fighting the immensely powerful Ottoman Empire over control of the Balkans was going to be a mighty challenge in itself. The last thing Austria needed was to be embroiled simultaneously in a war with Bohemia, especially since Bohemia was allied to the USE, and they needed to make peace with the Swede also. A heavy frown had formed on the Emperor's brow.
Surely you're not serious, Janosch. Wallenstein is a usurper and a traitor whose claims to Bohemia are specious. Preposterous, rather.
Yes, they are, Your Majesty. But I feel compelled to point out that any war with the Turks will strain us to the utmost. I think it most unwise to get entangled with Bohemia also.
Oh, that's nonsense, Janosch. I don't propose to fight the Turks anytime soon. We need Bohemia's resources. Surely, we can have it back in our hands within a year or two.
Surely we can't, Janosch felt like snarling. He hadn't been present himself at the Second Battle of the White Mountain, since he'd been assigned to the Turkish border at the time, but he'd heard many accounts of it from his fellow officers who had been present. Granted, they were junior officers who, as usual, were quick to criticize the failings of the top commanders in that battle. But the fact remained that while Austria might have won the battle with more capable commanders, it would still have been a savage affair. Nobody in their right mind dismissed Pappenheim lightly. not to mention that Wallenstein had proved himself to be one of Europe's most capable organizers of armies over a period of years. Any war with Bohemia, even a victorious war that resulted in a reconquest, would surely bleed Austria's armies badly. And that was the last thing they needed if they intended to confront the Ottomans. It was true that Bohemia had great resources, many of which were absent or scanty in the rest of the Austrian realm. But what good were resources that couldn't be obtained, by force at any rate? If they established a stable peace with Wallenstein, Janosch was fairly sure the Bohemians would be glad to provide those resources by way of trade, at a far smaller cost than the hideously expensive business of waging war. Alas, one of the things those American future histories had contained was a clear record that Ferdinand III, still merely the King of Hungary in that universe, since his father had lived a bit longer, had been, along with the Cardinal Infante, the co-commander of the Habsburg army that had inflicted a massive defeat on the Swedes at Nördlingen in 1634. That battle had not happened in this universe, and never would. But the record had been enough to infuse Ferdinand with self-confidence in his abilities as a military leader, which were simply premature in this universe. Janosch didn't doubt that his new monarch indeed possessed a talent for military affairs. He was talented in many things. But talent and experience were not the same thing, in war perhaps more than in any sphere of human affairs.
"A year or two," the emperor repeated forcefully. "March and see if I'm not right."
Janosch exchanged a glance with Zwickel. Some subtlety in Georg Bartholomaeus's expression made his attitude clear.
"Let it go, Janosch, at least for the moment. You're probably right, but you can't restrain him now."
Drugeth decided Zwickel was right. As foolish and costly as it might be, Austria's new ruler would simply have to learn some things for himself. And probably more than once, too. The thought would have been a gloomy one, perhaps, had Janosch not been a soldier. He'd seen very few officers, and certainly not himself, who'd learned their brutal trade without making mistakes. It was just the way things were.
"I simply felt it necessary to advance my opinion, Your Majesty," he said, trying to sound obedient but not submissive. "That said, in this, as in all things, you have my allegiance and support."
Ferdinand beamed.
"Well, good. In any event, Janosch, it's not something you're likely to be worrying about. Not directly, at least."
Here the emperor exchanged a meaningful look with Count von Kotze.
"Since you've done so well in Grantville, I propose to hand the entire operation to you, which Johann Jakob tells me is on the eve of coming to fruition."
Janosch wondered what the emperor meant by coming to fruition. The work that Janosch had set underway in Grantville some months earlier was intended to produce a slow and steady stream of technology transfer, including some personnel, from the USE to Austria. It was not the sort of project that ever came to fruition as such. Ferdinand rose from his chair and waved his hand airily.
"I have an audience I need to attend. The Count will explain it to you. But you'd best start packing, Janosch. You'll need to head out for Grantville on the morrow."
After Johann Jakob Kiesel explained what had been happening in Grantville over the months since Janosch had left for his inspection tour of the fortresses in the Balkans, Drugeth had to restrain himself from snarling again.
"In other words, in my absence, Henry Gage and Lion Gardiner, the benighted fools, allowed themselves to become cat's paws for a pack of American thieves."
Both Kiesel and his stepson looked startled.
"But," the Count began. "Don't you understand, Janosch?" said Georg Bartholomaeus. "At one swoop, we will get a far greater transfer than anything we'd envisioned."
"And then what?"
demanded Drugeth. He took a deep breath,
reminding himself that neither the Count nor his stepson had any personal acquaintance with Grantville or its uptime inhabitants. For them, as for most people in Europe, the Americans were a mysterious band of wizards. Drugeth had had the same impression himself until the weeks he'd spent there had made the truth clear to him. Grantville was a town, that's all. A town of people with knowledge and technical skills far advanced from any other in the world, true enough. But still, simply a town. Not of wizards, but of craftsmen. Simple folk, really, who understood in their bones something that most people who viewed them from a distance did not really understand at all. Their technical wizardry was the product of generations of skills compiled and passed on. Hard work lay at its root, not some sort of preposterous sorcery. There were no secrets in Grantville, no compendium of ultimate wisdom, no magic recipes, no magic spells, no magic wands. Most of all, no sorcerer's grimoire that, once seized, opened all technical secrets to the possessor.
"What then?" he repeated. "By the very manner in which this escapade will take place, there is no way to avoid this. The Americans will surely put in place measures that make any further transfers 10 times more difficult."
Finally, he did snarl.
"Not to mention that we will have done the Americans the great favor of draining the worst sort of people from their midst and planting them amongst us. For the love of God, these people are traitors and criminals. Who is to say they will not betray us in turn?"
For a moment, the memory of the 3 uptime mechanics whom he'd met at the racetrack earlier that day came to him. Janosch was sure they knew far more than they were admitting about matters that would be of direct benefit to Austria's power, not simply an emperor's whimsy. He knew, for instance, that while the 3 men insisted they were quite ignorant of all aeronautical matters, that at least one of them, Ronald Sanderlin, had served for months as a mechanic at the USE's Air Force Base in Wismar. He had to know how to construct at least the engine for a warplane, if not the plane itself. But Sanderlin would keep that knowledge to himself until and unless he became convinced that he could pass it on to Austrians without damaging his own nation. He was neither a traitor nor a thief.
Damnation! This was insane. They needed to make peace with the Swede and his Americans, not infuriate them, just as they needed to forget the past and make peace with Wallenstein.
The great foe of Austria was the Ottoman Empire, and would have been, even leaving aside the new emperor's determination, to take the Balkans from them. The 2 spymasters were still staring at him, obviously not understanding his concern. Spies and spymasters had their own limitations, he realized, produced by the very nature of their work. They dealt with criminals and traitors as a matter of course, which made sense from the standpoint of spying, but made no sense at all from the standpoint of forging a new nation. Janosch made a note to remember that in the future. Always.
"Never mind," he said. "What's done is done. I'll be off to Grantville at first light."
Chapter 3. The Elf. Grantville, State of Thuringia, Franconia, November 1634. Noelle Murphy, Noelle Stull now, having just changed her name legally, finished her report and leaned back in her chair. Sitting at the desk in his office, Tony Aducci did the same. He looked to Carol Unruh, sitting in another chair facing the desk at a diagonal from Noelle.
"Seems pretty complete to me, Carol. I'm not a lawyer, of course."
Noelle had to keep herself from smiling. "Not a lawyer," was putting it mildly. In point of fact, Tony Aducci's formal education extended to a high school diploma and 2 years at Fairmont State, from which he'd left to get a job in the mines without even picking up an AA degree. The main reason he'd been selected to be the Secretary of the Treasury for the new United States, not long after the Ring of Fire, was because he'd helped Frank Jackson keep the books for Mike Stearns's UMWA local. In those days, as was still the case more often than not, Mike selected his administrators primarily because he thought they were solid men he could rely on. Pedigrees and credentials be damned. And in the case of posts like Tony's, knew that they were honest. Noel's suppressed smile would have been simply one of amusement, however, not derision. When all was said and done, Mike's crude method had worked pretty well. It had given the new government he'd been forced to set up in the midst of a crisis and chaos a great deal of solidity and unity, however rough the edges might have been, and he'd simply shrugged off charges of UMWA favoritism. As the years had passed since the Ring of Fire, a number of those initial appointees had been gently eased out when it turned out they simply weren't up to the job. But Tony had kept his post through all of the transformations, from the NUS as an independent principality to its later status as a semi-independent principality within the Confederated Principalities of Europe, to its current, and hopefully final, manifestation as one of the provinces within the federal United States of Europe. Ed Piazza, who'd replaced Mike as the president of the SOTF after Mike became the prime minister of the USC and moved to Magdeburg, was no more inclined to replace a duchy than Stearns had been. He was capable, honest, and made up for his own lack of training by knowing how to use the skills of subordinates or associates who did have it. Such as Carol Unruh, in fact, Ron Koch's wife, although she'd kept her own name. Carol was the assistant director of the Department of Economic Resources, one of the branches of the Treasury Department. Her academic background might have been on the skimpy side for an equivalent position in the universe they'd come from, but by post-ROF Grantville standards, she was highly educated. She had a BA in mathematics and statistics and had taken graduate courses in the same subjects. She'd squeezed in the graduate courses on a part-time basis while she was bringing up her two children, but she'd always planned to go back full-time and finish her doctoral program once the kids were out of the house and she could really concentrate. Nobody much doubted she would have, either, except that the Ring of Fire had put paid to those plans as well as many others. Still, she was qualified enough to have been accepted as the University of Jena's instructor in statistics, whose male faculty was normally hostile to the idea of women teaching at the university level, outside of medicine and a few other special subjects. "Oh, it's plenty good enough to put Horace Bolander behind bars," she said.
"Keep him behind bars," Tony growled. "Noel and Eddie already got that much accomplished, the fucking bastard."
"He hasn't been convicted yet, Tony," Carol pointed out. "In fact, I think he's even going to manage to raise the bail money."
Again, Noel had to fight to keep from smiling. Not at Tony's praise, but at Carol's reaction. Unruh had the sort of prissy sense of duty that compelled her to add the caution, given that in cold-blooded personal terms, she stood to benefit the most if Horace Bolander got convicted. Her title of assistant director was something of a formality these days. Bolander had been the director of the Department of Economic Resources until Carol's suspicions and the investigative work by Noel and Eddie Juncker that those suspicions engendered had turned up plenty of evidence that the man had been using his post to feather his own nest. Now, Carol was actually running the department, and everyone expected that it wouldn't be long before President Piazza made her the official director. Where a different sort of person in her position might have been pushing for a conviction, Unruh was being meticulously fair-minded and scrupulous. That spoke well of her, of course, but Noelle still thought it was silly. She and Eddie had nailed the bastard, sure enough. It hadn't even been all that hard once they started digging. Like untold thousands of officials before him, Bolander had been sloppy about his demands for kickbacks before he assigned contracts. That was due more to arrogance than actual stupidity, probably, but the end result was no different. It was easy for an uptime official to get careless on the subject of bribes, since most downtimers took bribing officials to be a routine cost of business. He'd get a long, hard sentence, too. Bolender was not the first uptimer to have been caught breaking the law, but he was far and away the most prominent. Judge Tito was well known for his lack of leniency toward uptimers because he was bound and determined to prove to the citizens of the SOTF, which had 1 million people in it all told, that the tiny percentage of them who were of American origin weren't going to be getting any special treatment or favors from the law. Tony looked back at Noel. What else looks to be turning up? Besides Bolender and the Cunninghams and Norman Bell, I mean.
Nothing definite, yet. But Eddie and I are still digging. We don't think we rooted it all out by any means. We're almost certain that Stan Myers' tip regarding Mickey Simmons is a good one.
How about Myers himself? Asked Carol. It wouldn't be the first time a crook tried to deflect suspicion by fingering somebody else.
Noel shook her head.
Eddie and I don't think Stan's dirty. For one thing, because we just don't. Beyond that, Stan's in charge of the fire department's training program. He simply doesn't have access to the kind of temptation to ask for kickbacks that somebody like Bolender did. He's got a hard enough time as it is getting volunteers for the fire department, given all the other economic opportunities around.
Tony chuckled.
True enough. I can remember my dad complaining when he had to pass the dispatcher a $5 bill to get work out of his union's hiring hall, which was not the UMWA, he added self-righteously. But those jobs paid well, so he thought it was worth the backsheesh. Most of the fire department posts are volunteer. Don't pay anything more than expenses.
Carol nodded. I was just raising the possibility. I like Stan myself, and I've never gotten any sense he was crooked. Mickey Simmons, though.
She made a face.
Well, I should keep personalities out of it, I suppose.
He's a prick, stated Aducci. He's always been a prick. Why the hell it took Lorraine so long to give him the heave-ho is always a mystery to me.
He straightened up in his chair.
Just for the record. But I agree we should keep personalities out of it. There is such a thing as an honest butthead here and there. But I won't be surprised at all if Mickey turns out not to be one of them.
He mused for a moment, apparently lost in remembrances of things past. He really is a grade-A prick. But let's move on to the rest. How about the downtimers, Carol? Any decision yet from the Attorney General?
I just talked to Christoph yesterday. He feels in an awkward position given that he's a downtimer himself, so he stressed that he'd defer to your judgment on the matter. Still, he thinks it would be a mistake to press charges against any of the downtimers if their only involvement was having their arm twisted into paying the kickbacks. I'm inclined to agree.
Aducci grunted.
Yeah, so am I. Not that 17th century Germans haven't got at least as fine-tuned a sense of lawyering as any West Virginian ever did. They knew damn good and well they were breaking the law, too. Still, you have to make allowances for the chaos caused by 15 years of war half-wrecking the Germanies. People slide into bad habits in situations like that. For us to run around hammering everybody probably wouldn't be a good idea. Still, this is it, folks. You also got to watch out for being paternalistic about these things. Downtimers ain't children. Once these cases break and we start putting people in prison, let's make sure the message gets out to every businessman in the province who's thinking of cutting a deal beneath the table. Do it again, and we'll bust you, sure and certain.
Noel thought their attitude was probably the right one to take, though she was even more inclined than they were not to err on the side of paternalistic tolerance.
It's just their traditional ways, baloney.
Her partner Eddie Junker was a downtimer, and he'd never had any trouble recognizing that paying a kickback was just as illegal, if not perhaps as personally reprehensible, as demanding it in the first place. That said, she was a little relieved. Her relations with Eddie had gotten awkward lately, and she was pretty sure she knew the reason. Now, with this decision having been made, she could see her way clear to straightening it out.
Aducci raised an admonishing finger. But that only applies to downtimers whose involvement was simply paying the kickback. Any of them who got more, what you might call enthusiastic and enterprising about the business, we'll go after them just like we are the uptimers.
For the third time in half an hour, Noelle had to fight to keep a smile from her face. That wouldn't be a problem for her, at least. Klaus Juncker might have been willing enough in the enthusiasm department, but when it came to enterprise, it was just a fact that Eddie's father was a hopeless nincompoop. He bore about as much resemblance to a criminal mastermind as... She tried to think of anyone she knew who could possibly be as inept as Klaus Juncker at the art of making a deal. The only person she could come up with was her own mother. She must have choked or something.
"What's so funny, Noelle?" asked Carol.
"Ah, nothing. Just an idle thought." Janos Drugeth's agents in Grantville, the Englishman Henry Gage and Lion Gardiner, seemed bound and determined to waste more time continuing the recriminations.
"In particular," said Gage with exasperation, "I told you to stay away from the Barlow family."
Gardiner scowled at him.
"And I did, until I was approached by Neil O'Connor, who was part of the affair because you recruited his father, Alan."
Gage looked defensive.
"We need the O'Connors. Between the father's knowledge of steam engines and the son's experience working on aircraft, they'll be invaluable. And we need Peter Barclay and his wife, too. They both have experience in mechanical design."
"We don't need..."
Gage threw up his hands.
"Of course we don't need their crazy daughter.
But the Barclays insisted that the children had to be part of the bargain or they wouldn't agree."
Sullenly, he added,
"It's not my fault. It's certainly not my fault that the oldest girl, Susie Barclay, lives in a state of sin with Neil O'Connor, and she told him, and he told his father, and..."
He broke off there. Gardiner picked it right up, now with a sneer on his face.
"And she also told her friend Karen Barlow, who is almost as crazy as she is, not surprising, being the daughter of Jay Barlow, and she told her father, and there we were, in the soup."
"Enough," said Janos stolidly. Rubbing the back of his neck, he looked around the small apartment his two subordinates had been renting on the outskirts of Grantville. At least they had enough sense to be packed and ready to go.
"This is pointless, and we have little time remaining."
He gave Gardiner a cold eye.
"Do restrain your indignation. It was you, after all, who recruited the Simmons fellow, who has no skills I am aware of beyond embezzlement, and paltry skills at that, judging from the evidence."
It was Gardiner's turn to look defensive.
"That wasn't my doing. The O'Connors insisted that their employee Timothy Kennedy should be included also, seeing as he was very skilled in the steamwork and was now disaffected from his wife."
Seeing his chance, Gage interrupted with a sneer.
"Who just happens to be the sister of Anita Massaniello, who just happens to be the wife of Steve Salato, who just happens to be the American official in charge of administering Franconia."
Gardiner glared up.
"As I recall, you thought recruiting Kennedy was a good idea at the time yourself. He seemed tight-lipped enough. How was I, or you, to know that he was good friends with Mickey Simmons and Simmons was up to his neck?"
"Enough," growled Janos.
He wiped his face tiredly. Part of his weariness was due to the rigors of the hard and fast journey he'd made from Vienna, much of which had been on horseback through forests and mountains to evade the USE's border patrols. Most of it, though, was simply weariness at the whole business. He was still aggravated by István's foolishness in having hired these two English adventurers as his direct agents in Grantville, as much as he was aggravated by the adventurers themselves. But, being fair to all parties, he also recognized that most of the problem was simply due to the nature of the work involved. This miserable business the Americans called covert operations. True, Gardiner and Gage were mercenary adventurers. On the other hand, they spoke fluent, now even idiomatic, English, in a town of English speakers whose usage of the language was eccentric to begin with by 17th century standards. It was doubtful that any regular Austrian agents could have penetrated so deeply and quickly into the disaffected elements among the Americans. That was true even leaving aside the thugs who infested the so-called Club 250, who were automatically suspicious of any Central Europeans. None of the thugs themselves were part of any particular interest to Austria, which could recruit plenty of thugs of its own. But the Club 250 served as something of a liaison venue for other disaffected uptimers that Austria was interested in. Gage and Gardner could go there easily. Between their excellent knowledge of the American idiom and the fact they were English, for reasons still somewhat murky to Drugeth, the American bigots who patronized the Club 250 made an exemption for Englishmen. The two of them could habituate the place where, if Janosch went himself, he'd likely face a fracas. True, also, most, perhaps all, of the Americans they were seeking to recruit were not what any sane man would consider upright and moral persons. At best, their guiding motives were nakedly mercenary. For some of them, such as Simmons, you could add a desire to escape apprehension by the SOTF's authorities for criminal activity. For others, like the O'Connors and their employee Timothy Kennedy, their extravagant and careless spending habits had led them to drive a seemingly prosperous business into a state of near bankruptcy. As for the craziness of the Susie Barclay girl, a subject on which both Gage and Gardner could expound at length, what was to be expected from the offspring of such parents? He rubbed his face again. In the end, all the problems were simply inherent to the business itself. If a man insists on sticking his hand into a marsh looking for gold, he can hardly be surprised if he retrieves filth and leeches as well as the gold he was looking for. And there was gold there, sure enough, being fair to the two. Whatever the moral and mental characteristics of the uptimers whom Gage and Gardner had recruited to move to Vienna and provide the Austrian Empire with technological skills and advice, there was no question that they'd assembled an impressive group. Amongst them, there was extensive knowledge of American machining techniques, mechanical design, and steam engine design, not to mention the seemingly ubiquitous knowledge that American males had with regard to automobile engines. There was even a fair knowledge of aircraft principles, something which was in scant supply even among Americans. Still, it was a mess. The original plan had been modified after the end of the war between the USA and the League of Ostend brought a period of peace. That, combined with the outcome of the Congress of Copenhagen and the decision of the SOTF to relocate its capital from Grantville to Bamberg, was producing a massive wave of emigration of Americans out of Grantville to other parts, and not all of them to somewhere else in the USA. It seemed as if every nation in Europe had launched a recruitment program here, even the French. Most of those who chose to leave the USA, of course, went to either Prague or Copenhagen or the Netherlands. Bohemia and Denmark were allied to the USA, and while the new kingdom in the Low Countries was not, it enjoyed quite friendly relations these days. Nowhere in Europe had the now-romantic figure of the Netherlands' new queen Maria Anna assumed such legendary proportions as it had in Grantville. The Wheelbarrow Queen, they called her, often enough. Even the rambunctious and surly commoners of Magdeburg seemed inclined to favor the Netherlands, monarchy or not. Janosch had hopes that eventually, that same romanticism might help relations between the USA and his own nation. Maria Anna was, after all, a daughter of the Habsburgs and one of the new emperor's two sisters. At one time, not more than a few months ago, an archduchess of Austria itself. It was too early for that, of course. Everyone in the USA was expecting a new war to begin the coming spring with Saxony and Brandenburg. And everyone was assuming, accurately, alas, unless Janosch could persuade the emperor otherwise, that Austria would weigh in on the side of the USA's enemies. Still, Janosch had hoped to keep tensions between Austria and the USA, especially its Americans, to a minimum. Sooner or later, he was sure Austria would have to seek peace with the USA, and he didn't want any more in the way of festering anger than was inevitable in the course of a war. So, clearly and unequivocally, he had told István Janosi to instruct his agents to keep any transfer of personnel and equipment from Grantville within the limits of the law, as the Americans saw it. That hadn't seemed too difficult a project at the time. The uptimers had sweeping notions on the subject of personal liberties, which included the right to emigrate and included the right to maintain personal property in the process. The key figures, the O'Connors and the Barclays, were in a position to do that. Simply move themselves and their businesses to Vienna. Impossible, of course, to move the actual physical plants, but they could certainly take with them all of their technical designs, blueprints, those seemed to be called, and even much of the movable equipment, over time, if not immediately. Unfortunately, what Janosch hadn't foreseen was the inevitability of what followed. Like anything dragged out of a swamp, be it gold-colored or not, the Barlows and the O'Connors were sticky. They had relatives and friends. The relatives and friends had their own such, and among them, what a surprise, were some individuals whom no one in their right mind would want to encourage to move into his own country. And so, a legal enterprise had become an illegal one. Not only were some of these people going to be fleeing the authorities of the USE, they were going to be taking goods and possessions with them that they had no legal right to take. For a moment, Drugeth considered simply forbidding any such goods, but he dismissed the idea almost as soon as it came to him. First, because that was bound to produce a quarrel with the would-be emigrants, and there was no time left for such a quarrel. Second, even more simply, because Drugeth really had no way to know which goods were legal and which weren't in the first place. Once the expedition got to the Austrian border, he had a large cavalry unit waiting to escort them all the rest of the way to Vienna. But from here to the border, he'd have only Gage and Gardner to assist him in keeping control over the uptimers. What was he to do? Insist on a search of the wagons, not even knowing what he was looking for? It was just a mess, that's all. A marshy muck. But Janosch had crossed marshes and swamps often enough since he took the Austrian colors. Though he was only 25 years old, he had plenty of experience as a soldier. He figured he could manage this well enough.
"Tomorrow morning, then," he said. "We start to leave as early as possible."
Chapter 4. The Biker. 3 days later in the evening, over the sandwiches they were having by way of a working meal on the folding table in Noelle's apartment, she finally nailed her partner.
"All right, Eddie, spill it. I got the word from Carol Unruh over lunch today. For what it's worth, she, Antonia Ducci, and Christoph Wieland officially decided that no charges would be pressed against any downtimer unless they were actively involved as one of the arm twisters. Just paying the bribes? We'll let it go. This time, anyway."
Eddie Junker laid his half-eaten sandwich down on the plate, then stared at it for a moment before sighing.
"It has been difficult. I've felt bad about it. Not saying anything to you, I mean."
"Yeah, I can see that. How deep was your father involved?"
Eddie shrugged uncomfortably. "Not as deep as I'm sure he would have liked to have been. Dear God in heaven, when will my father learn that he has a business sense of...
"My mother,"
Noel said crisply. For a moment they both shared a laugh.
Noel's mother, Pat, was to good sense what a junkyard was to orderly. The woman wasn't stupid. She just didn't seem to have a clue how to separate abstractions from their application to the real world. In her favor, though, Noel thought, but didn't say out loud, at least Pat wasn't greedy, something which couldn't be said for Klaus Junker.
"The point is, Eddie, nobody's going to go after your dad. But I'd like to know if there are any leads there."
Eddie used the time it took to finish the sandwich to compose his thoughts. Then,
"I think so, yes.
Do you know a man, an uptimer, by the name of J. Barlow, and another one by the name of Alan O'Connor?
Noel stared at him for a moment. J. Barlow, yeah, she said abruptly. He used to be a car dealer before the Ring of Fire, mostly used cars, and he was pretty much a poster boy for what people think of used car dealers.
Eddie frowned. Which is what? Never mind. Crooked sleazeball is close enough. The kind of guy whose stock in trade was passing off lemons.
I thought you said he sold automobiles.
Never mind. Like I said, some other time I'll enhance your vocabulary of uptime slang. But right now, I want you to concentrate on the other guy. Alan O'Connor, you said?
Yes. I think he's actually the more important of the two, although my father's direct dealings were with Barlow.
Noel chuckled.
Well, yeah, I can believe that. In the T.O. of organized crime, like any other enterprise I can think of, you'll find the J. Barlows of the world pretty regularly enrolled under the rank of foot soldier.
That's a T.O.
Table of organization. Like I said, later for the vocabulary lesson.
She scratched the tip of her chin, forgetting for a moment her long-standing vow to eliminate that mannerism, on account of it drew attention to her chin. She thought it was on the pointy side, which was especially unfortunate given the shape of her ears, which were also too damn close to being pointed. Add into the miserable bargain her too slim figure, which she'd had since she was a kid, even before she started exercising regularly. She began that regimen after the scares she'd experienced in Franconia during the Ram Rebellion convinced her she'd better be in top physical condition. All she needed in her position was for people to think she was some kind of elf. Catching herself, she stopped. Then tugged at her earlobe. Then silently chided herself and brought the hand firmly down on the table.
O'Connor, on the other hand, has the potential to rise to higher levels. Did rise to higher levels, in fact, not long after the Ring of Fire when he set up a steam engine business.
So did Barlow, Eddie pointed out. He's the partner and co-manager of the Grantville Zalfeld Foundries and Metalworks, which is quite an important and profitable enterprise. More so than O'Connor's Steam Engine Corporation, really.
Noel sneered, forgetting momentarily her long-standing vow never to sneer on account of it made her look like an impudent elf.
Yeah, sure, but that's due to the other partner, Bart Kubiak, who's the brains of the outfit. I heard, never mind where, that the only reason Bart asked Jay to become his partner, and he doesn't have anything close to an equal share in the business, by the way, just a token amount, is because Billie Jean May's sweet-talked him into it, and Bart wanted her to relocate to Zalfeld to be his office manager.
She shook her head.
There's another mixed blessing character for you. By all accounts, Billie Jean is a crackerjack office manager.
I thought those were a kind of cereal candy.
What is it with your sudden obsession with learning every bit of American slang in one sitting? But whatever skills Billie Jean has in an office, she's a dumb blonde in the rest of her life.
Eddie was now eyeing Noelle's hair dubiously.
Fine, she snapped. It's sort of blonde. It's just an expression. Some of the world's champion dumb blondes are brunettes and redheads. Trust me on this one, for just a moment. Who else but a dumb blonde would ever get hooked up with a guy like J. Barlow? You can't even credit her with being a gold digger since she brings in most of the gold.
She raised the fingers of her left hand and began counting them off with the thumb and forefinger of her right hand, forgetting also her solemn vow not to draw attention to her fingers because they were too slender and nimble and, well, sort of elf-like.
First, he's a loser. Second, he's a sleazebag. Third, I thought the term was sleazeball, Eddie complained.
Noel contemplated strangling him,
then simultaneously concluded her hands were far too delicate for the task.
Eddie was on the heavily built side, and remembered her vow not to display them. Hurriedly, she put her hands back in her lap.
Third,
she said forcefully. He's 13 years older than she is. Remembering my charitable Christian nature, Eddie was looking more dubious by the minute, I will forego pointing out that his potbelly matches his age and then some. Fourth, he's lazy. Fifth, since after 2 months Bart Kubiak gave him the boot and told him to enjoy his piddly little share of the partnership back in Grantville where he'd be out of Bart's hair, he spends most of his waking hours lounging at the 250 Club, trying to pretend he is a tough biker, even if the only part of biker he has down is the boozing. Sixth. She broke off suddenly and stared at the wall. Nothing there to look at, just getting an idea.
What is it? Eddie asked.
She started scratching her chin again, forgetting her solemn vow to work on her memory so it wouldn't resemble Swiss cheese. Just what she needed, having people think she was as flighty as an elf.
I was just thinking, now that I think about it, that Jay Barlow is the mirror opposite of Buster Beasley. There's a guy who has tough biker down pat every other way, except he finds most bikers pretty boring. So he doesn't hang out much at the 250 Club, true enough. But I'll bet he knows where all the bones are buried and whose skeleton is rattling which bike. He's honest, too. Well, allowing for a certain casual attitude toward mind-altering substances and stuff like that, but who cares? Those laws aren't in force anymore, and even if they were, you and I are working for the Treasury Department, not the old DEA.
I am now completely lost, said Eddie.
Noel flashed him a grin, forgetting her solemn vow to suppress her quick way of smiling, since she thought that was probably the silly way that elves smiled if elves existed, which they didn't, but too many damn people had heard of them and thought they probably did, and she was suspect number one. I'll introduce you. She glanced at the clock on the wall. It's only 8. He's probably still at his storage rental place. She got up, grabbed her purse, and shrugged into her coat, then headed for the door. Eddie followed. If we're lucky, maybe his daughter Denise is there, too. There's a real pip. Outside, Eddie asked, What is a pip? Noelle did her best to explain as they walked. She'd never realized before just how hard it could be to explain a colloquial term like a real pip. But when she was done, Eddie nodded sagely.
Ah, sort of an American elf.
There's no such thing as an elf, Noel snapped. She thought his ensuing silence had a dubious flavor, too.
Forget Simmons, said Buster Beasley. With the booted foot he had planted on an overturned crate, he kept rocking back and forth on his chair. Given that it wasn't a rocking chair, just a beat-up old wooden kitchen chair, and given Buster's heft, Noel wondered how much longer it would last.
Simmons is a clown, he continued.
The light cast into the office of Buster's rental storage operation from a single naked light bulb in the ceiling threw his face into deep shadows, making him look more like a prophet than the middle-aged, long-haired, heavily bearded and burly ex-biker that he was. If you ignored the muscular arms, exposed by the cutaway denim jacket, anyway. Noel was familiar with the lives of many of the saints and the Old Testament prophets, and she was quite sure not one of them had a born-to-raise-hell tattoo on their shoulder, with or without a dagger through it.
He can manage to slice bread on his own, I suppose, but anything more complicated would stump him for sure. The only reason he got that job heading up the training program for the Department of Transportation was because his ex-wife Lorraine talked her twin sister Lauren into getting it for him, even though she dumped the bum years ago.
Buster's 15-year-old daughter Denise was perched on an upended crate not far away, as was Eddie. Noel had been given the one stool in the office to sit on. She'd have preferred a crate herself, actually, since the stool looked to be as rickety as the one and only chair in the office that was getting a workout from Buster.
I don't get it, Dad,
Denise said. The girl's expression was one of intense curiosity, which seemed to fit her face quite nicely.
She shook her head a little, causing her long dark hair to ripple.
I mean, sure, I like Lorraine. Who doesn't? But where'd she get the pull to land an ex-husband? Not even the guy she's married to now. A job that good.
Denise didn't seem to think there was anything odd about her father calling another man a bum and clown. This, despite the fact that Buster's office furniture consisted of upside-down crates and stools, a cheap metal cabinet that looked like an antique, except no antique shop would have bothered trying to restore anything that badly stained and covered with rust spots, and a desk. Noelle was still trying not to grin at the thing. That was actually the bed of a junkyard pickup truck that Buster must have cut out with a torch and provided with legs made out of parts from the frames of old motorcycles. He ran a welding business on the side and was quite good at it. Good enough, in fact, that if he'd concentrated on that business, he could have become very prosperous. But Buster valued his free time a lot more than he did money. Noelle wasn't surprised by Denise's respect for her father, quite evident despite the relaxed and informal ease of their relationship. Buster Beasley, like Tom Stone, was one of those people who managed to live outside the normal boundaries of social custom without being considered a hopeless screwball. Screwball, maybe. Hopeless, no. They were just too effective at managing their lives, each in their own way. In Buster's case, of course, the tattoos helped stifle vocal criticism, especially combined with the 17-inch biceps displayed by the cutout jacket. Not to mention the scars. Despite her appearance, which she'd inherited from her mother, slender and very attractive, where Buster was neither, Denise was a chip off the old block. She was just a few weeks shy of her 16th birthday. Most girls her age would have been either egotistical or confused by her good looks and the effect it had on boys. Denise was neither. She took it for granted, didn't seem to care in the least. She certainly didn't pick her girlfriends based on their looks, and God help the overeager high school boy who didn't take no seriously. Denise was the only girl Noelle knew who'd been hauled in front of the high school vice principal for punching a kid out. Fortunately, there weren't too many boys stupid enough to harass Buster Beasley's daughter. Buster gave his daughter a grin.
How many times have I told you not to underestimate networking skills?
Denise snorted.
Coming from you. He shrugged. I didn't say I was good at it. I just told you not to underestimate them. In this case, sure, Lorraine doesn't have any direct clout worth talking about, but...
He held up his thumb.
Her twin sister Lauren owns and runs the town's best restaurant, along with her husband Calvin.
He raised his forefinger alongside the thumb.
If there's a power that be in Grantville that doesn't hang out there, I don't know who it is.
The middle finger came up to join them.
For sure and certain, Joe Stull, remember him? He's the Secretary of Transportation, eats lunch there practically every day.
Buster brought up the ring finger, somehow managing not to haul the little finger along with it. He was a very well-coordinated man, despite the graying beard and the muscle.
Moving right along, since Lauren and Calvin Tyler's daughter Rachel has all the sense when it comes to men that Lorraine doesn't, she married that Scott cavalryman, Edward Graham, who, he ain't no dummy either, immediately left the Swedish colors and wrangled himself a partnership in the restaurant with his new in-laws, and,
finally the little finger came up,
that damn Scotsman could charm a rattlesnake, which Joe Stull ain't, and Graham makes it a point to be the waiter any time a big shot shows up.
Denise was looking a little cross-eyed by now. For that matter, Noelle thought she might be herself. The fingers started closing back down, one at a time, gracefully, despite their heft.
So Lorraine talked to Lauren, and she talked to Graham, and Graham put in a word with Joe Stull, and I guess Joe must have been having one of his rare off days because he agreed to hire the clown. And that's how it happened.
Throughout, he hadn't varied in the slightest the metronome regularity of his chair rocking. Now he looked back to Noelle.
So, like I said, forget Simmons. He gestured with his thumb to the tattoo on his shoulder. If Mickey had a tattoo, it'd read, Born to be a small-time loser. Nope, the people you want to start looking at are the Barclays. Noel frowned. Pete Barkley? The guy who works for Dave Marcantonio?
Yep, him and his wife Marina. She works there too, you know.
He finally ceased the chair rocking and stood up, then picked up a big black flashlight perched on a shelf, one of those long, heavy maglights favored by cops because they could double as a club in a pinch. Buster was holding it the way cops did, too, with the lamp cupped in his hand and the shaft perched on his shoulder, ready to swing forward if need be. So far as Noel knew, Buster Beasley hadn't been in a brawl in years. But he'd been notorious for brawling in his younger years, if not for starting fights, certainly for ending them. And he clearly still had the ingrained habits. The big ex-biker headed for the door, not bothering to put on a coat to fend off the autumn chill outside.
Come on, let me show you something.
A minute later, they were staring into one of Buster's storage sheds. It was one of the big ones, down by the end.
There's nothing in it, said Eddie, puzzled.
Not today, sure enough. But if you'd looked into it 3 mornings ago, you would have found it packed full. The Barclays showed up right when I opened, along with Alan and Neil O'Connor. I think most of the stuff belonged to them, actually, even though the Barclays are the ones who paid the rent, and cleaned it all out. They had 3 wagons for the purposes. Well-built wagons, driven by some downtimers, I don't know. The guy who seemed to be in charge was a real dandy, dressed to the hilt, fancy plumed hat, the whole works.
Noel hissed. The O'Connors? But there seemed to be a thin smile on Buster's face. Between the beard and the darkness, though, it was hard to tell.
But they have a successful business here? I wouldn't be too sure of that, the way they go through money like it was water. I can tell you this much for sure. Since the Barclays rented this shed 6 months ago, they've been steadily filling it up with mechanical equipment. Smallish stuff, of course, no big machines. Tools, blueprints, diagrams, you name it. I'm pretty sure some of it was swiped from Marcantonio's machine shop, although I couldn't swear to it.
Oh, wow, said Denise. Dad, the fuckers are defecting.
That's my guess. Got no idea where to, though.
Noel's lips were tight.
You know, Buster, you could have maybe said something about this earlier.
He swiveled to face her. Whatever smile might have been on his face was gone now.
Said something to who?
The so-called authorities?
Meaning no offense, Ms. Murphy.
It's stall now. I changed it.
Good for you, said Denise. I kind of like your mother, but her ex-husband, the guy who was supposed to be your dad and wasn't, is a complete shithead.
Clearly enough, whatever parental instruction Buster had felt it necessary to give his daughter had never included proper language for a young lady. Noel couldn't really fault Buster for that, though. He made a lot better father in everything essential than Frances Murphy had. She didn't doubt that in the least.
Yeah, good for you, echoed Buster. Your real dad Dennis is an okay guy in my book, but like I was saying, Ms. Stahl, I mind my own business. I'm as likely to go to the cops as I am to eat tofu for breakfast. I got along with Dan Frost well enough once him and me straightened out a few issues, but I've generally got as much use for cops as I do for cockroaches, especially since, in this case, I can't see where they were doing anything illegal anyway, except for maybe some petty theft from Dave's machine shop.
He gave his daughter a stern look.
How is it defecting when we're not at war with anybody any longer? People got a right to live wherever they want, you know, and take their property with them. You really ought to watch your language, young lady.
Noel barked a laugh. For his part, Eddie gave Buster a wary look.
We're not actually policemen, he said. No powers of arrest, we're just investigators.
Buster shrugged. Like the guy I said in that Muppet movie, authorities is authorities.
He didn't say that, Denise protested. He said,
do you want to help them? Demanded her father, gesturing with a thumb at Noel and Eddie.
Yeah, sure. I don't care what you say, Dad. Those fuckers are defecting. Bunch of traitors.
Then quit arguing with me about movie dialogue and get a move on. He turned back to Noel and Eddie, smiling again. If you want to catch them, you'd better plan on starting at dawn. They'll have 3 days head start on you wherever they're going.
You have no idea?
Not a clue. Like I said.
And your own business, I heard you.
Noel tried not to sound too snappish and testy. Despite his appearance, Buster was generally an easygoing sort of fella. Still, aggravating a large ex-biker on his own property in the middle of the night when he was carrying an 18-inch flashlight in his hand did not strike Noel as falling into the category of good idea. Eddie was scratching his head.
We'll need to alert the police first, then we'll have to figure out which way they went.
Denise grinned.
I'll find that out for you. Me and my bike. I'll get started as soon as it's light enough to see anything.
Ain't she a pip, said her father, admiringly.
Chapter 5. The Nature of Plans. Near Grantville, State of Thuringia, Franconia.
Fucking idiots what they are, pronounced Denise. She finished the beer she'd ordered at Stefan Wernbrunt's roadside tavern just outside Grantville on the road to Rudolstadt and almost slammed the glass back on the bar. She glared around the room as if defying any of its habitués to challenge either her use of language or her judgment of police chiefs and cavalry officers. No challenge came forth, except from Lanny Yost, perched on a nearby stool. Owlishly, he peered at her empty glass.
Ain't you a little young to be drinking that stuff?
Denise gaped at him. So did several of the other barflies in the place. In their case, because they were downtime Germans who thought the notion of anyone being underage to drink beer was silly, one of those uptime fetishes they'd thought must have died a natural death by now, 3.5 years after the Ring of Fire. In Denise's case, because her father was Buster Beasley, and she thought, so did Buster actually, that she was practically abstemious when it came to substance abuse. She was also gaping because she was outraged, of course.
You, Lanny Yost, you're pie-eyed half the time, so-called test pilot. You got some nerve.
Hey, Denise, take it easy. I wasn't trying to pick no fight.
That wouldn't normally have done him any good at all, except, he added hurriedly,
you got the right of it when it comes to Captain Neffler, that's for sure. Guy couldn't find his ass with both hands in broad daylight. That jackass, I told him I found their trail, leading south from Rudolstadt, but no, Mr. Military Genius insisted they must have used those rafts the one guy, the one in charge, whoever he is, bought in Jena.
By now, the news had spread all over the area, including some of the details.
The rafts were gone,
one of the downtimers pointed out. He was sitting with a friend at a table nearby. Denise sniffed.
Big deal. All the guy in charge, and I think he's got more brains in his little toe than Neffler does, had to do was hire a few men to pole the rafts downriver. There's day laborers hanging around all over the place in Jena. Probably told them they needed to pick up something in Halle and take it down to Magdeburg. Off goes whichever idiot came in pursuit. His name's Neffler, did I mention that? It's spelled K-N like in numbskull, while the guy with the brains keeps heading up the Zala Valley. Hadn't it struck any of you geniuses yet that Mr. Whoever is good at this? Why would he have been wearing such a flamboyant outfit just to buy some cargo rafts if he hadn't been trying to draw attention to himself?
She was pretty proud of that deductive logic. Maybe she ought to become a detective when she grew up. Finished growing up. Which she was practically there. She'd bet Minnie would partner with her.
On the other hand, she'd neglected to mention that Mr. Whoever he was had been wearing the same outfit when he arrived at her father's storage place to load the wagons. Obviously, just to make sure, every idiot in Grantville connected obvious dot A to blatant dot B. The Grantville police chief and Captain Numbskull had squeezed that information out of her, despite her misgivings about what they'd do with it, but she saw no reason to weaken her case by divulging it to these layabouts. Lanny took a swallow from his own beer. You think?
Sure. What sort of lunatic would make his escape further into the USE?
The same downtimer wasn't ready to let it go.
Not so foolish, Zat. Before he gets to Halle, he can offload the rafts and make his way into Saxony. Probably he's working for John George.
Denise opened her mouth, then decided it wasn't worth the effort to get into an argument with somebody who was obviously not playing with a full deck. Right. Sure. That made sense. In 6 months, the Elector of Saxony was staring in the face an all-out invasion by Gustav Adolf. Fat lot of good some tech transfer would do him at this stage of the game. Except give Gustav Adolf another Cassius Belli, or whatever the name was of that ancient Roman guy who'd caused a war. Denise might be willing to concede that John George was that stupid, but none of the uptimer traders were that dumb, except maybe Jay Barlow and Mickey Simmons. Even Susie Barclay wasn't that dumb, just nuts. No, wherever the lousy defectors were going, it was someplace they figured could hold off the USE at least for a while. That had meant Austria, probably. That had been Noel's guess. Or maybe Bavaria. Lanny finished his beer and stood up. The motion was just a little bit too exaggerated to be that of a completely sober man. Which, given Lanny, was no surprise. He wasn't actually drunk, just in his more normal-than-not state of a pleasant buzz. Lanny's alcoholism wasn't so bad that he couldn't get by in life, with his rare skills. Jesse Wood hadn't been willing to accept him in the Air Force, but the Kellys used him for their test pilot.
"Okay, then," he said. "Give me a ride back to Grantville on your bike, kid. I'll nail the bastards for you."
Denise frowned.
"What are you talking about?"
He slapped his chest.
"When the cavalry falls down on the job, you got to call in the Air Force. One of the planes at the facility, that's the Dauntless, is finished and ready to go."
Denise stopped laughing after a while, then shrugged.
"Sure, why not? I'll take you there. I'm warning you, though. Those hands of yours better not move around any while you're holding on to me."
Lanny looked aggrieved.
"Hey, there's no call for that. Besides, I ain't crazy enough to piss off your dad."
Denise squinted at him.
"You start groping, and my dad will be the least of your worries."
The Zala Valley, south of Zalfeld.
"It has to be them," Noel pronounced.
Eddie sighed and wiped his face. His whole body ached from spending 3 days in the saddle, especially his thighs.
"No, actually, it doesn't. They passed through Zalfeld yesterday evening in bad lighting, and the guards we talked to didn't recognize anybody. Just 3 wagons, which they didn't give any more than a cursory inspection if they gave them any at all, because they most likely got bribed. So they're not exactly elite troops in that garrison, now that nobody's worried any longer about another raid deep into the Thüringerwald. Even if they weren't bribed, they probably wouldn't have bothered to check the wagons anyway. You have any idea how many times heavily loaded wagons have passed through Zalfeld?"
"It has to be them," Noel repeated stubbornly.
She swiveled in the saddle, the slight carefulness of the motion making it clear she wasn't feeling any too spry herself.
"We should have gotten reinforcements by now. I guess Denise couldn't get anybody to take her seriously. Maybe I should have..."
"You weren't going to stay behind since you can't resist the thrill of the chase. I couldn't stay behind because somebody has to look after you. That left Denise, and we practically had to sit on her to get her to agree."
He wiped his face again.
"And yes, they probably didn't take her seriously. Given that she would have had to report to Captain Neffler, him now being the commander of the Grantville garrison,
and Nephila is a jackass. He smiled. Probably after 10 seconds or so, Denise started denouncing him. She's a real pip, that one. Noel eyed him suspiciously. She's only 16 years old, not even that. All the more reasons they wouldn't take her seriously. That's not what I was referring to. I was referring to the possibility of other men taking her too seriously.
Don't be ridiculous.
The Zala Valley near Hof.
Stop complaining, Janos said.
He gave the wagon a cold, experienced eye.
The likelihood of having an axle break was very high, given the route we've taken and the speed we've made.
And that's another thing, complained Billie Jean Mays. You've been wearing everybody out.
Janos didn't bother replying to that accusation. In point of fact, while the pace he'd set had been hard by the standards of a commercial caravan, it was nothing compared to the pace Hungarian cavalrymen and their supply trains were accustomed to while on campaign. He was feeling perfectly well-rested himself. Granted, he'd been in a saddle, but Gage and Gardner had been driving two of the three wagons, and they were holding up well also. Of the three drivers, the one in the worst shape was Mickey Simmons. He'd gotten the assignment because he'd boasted of the wagoneering skills he'd developed as a result of being the coordinator of training for the transportation department. Naturally, within less than 4 days, he'd broken an axle.
There's no time for this, Janos said curtly.
He glanced up at the sun.
We'll camp here. We have perhaps 3 hours of daylight left to sort through the wagons, jettison whatever is least important, and repack the two surviving wagons.
Needless to say, he didn't think he'd ever met such self-indulgent people. They were even worse than Austrian noblemen. The Americans set up a round of protests and complaint, the gist of which was, "We need all of it." He gave them no more than a minute before cutting the nonsense short.
"We have no means of repairing the axle, nor can we seek the assistance of a Wainwright in Hof, because there is a USE garrison there. By now, the alert will have reached them. Like most such garrisons, they will not exert themselves to search the surrounding countryside. But if we show up in the town itself, which is quite small, they will be almost certain to spot us."
He gave the assembled uptimers perhaps 5 seconds of a stony stare to see if any were stupid enough to argue those points. None were, apparently. He revised his estimate of their common sense. Higher than carrots, after all.
"That leaves two options. The first is that we unload the contents of the broken wagon and pile them onto the two others."
"Yeah, that's what I was figuring," said Jay Barlow. Sadly, the level of common sense did not attain that of rabbits. Janos half turned and pointed southeast toward a low range of mountains.
"By tomorrow, we have to be well into the Fichtelgebirge. That terrain is considerably worse than we've been passing through, and the roads are worse yet. We are certain to break another axle or a wheel with overloaded wagons, and these are already dangerously burdened as it is. I leave aside the fact that we are now into late autumn. The weather has been good so far, for which we can be thankful. But who knows when the weather might turn?"
The Americans squinted at the mountains.
"We gotta go up there," whined Peter Barclay's wife, Marina.
By now, Janos had come to recognize her as a champion whiner. She almost put his great-aunt Orshoya in the shade. Not quite.
"Why?"
demanded her husband. Janos shook his head.
"This close to Bayreuth. We can't stay in the lowlands, or we run the risk of being spotted by a cavalry troop. Even in the Fichtelgebirge, there may be an occasional patrol. Once we enter it, we can take only a few days, no more, to reach Hep by following the Eger."
The Barclay's daughter, Susie, frowned. She was a bizarre-looking creature who would have been an attractive young woman if it hadn't been for the short-cropped hair dyed a truly hideous color, 5 earrings in her left ear and 3 on the right, 2 metal studs through her right eyebrow, and, capping it all,
a tattoo of flames done in black ink, reaching from the wrist of her right arm to the top of the right side of her neck. The woman was so attached to the grotesque decoration that she insisted on wearing a sleeveless vest instead of a coat, despite the November temperatures. "That can't be right," she said. "I know somebody from Cheb. One of the girls, well, never mind that, but she's Bohemian."
"That is hardly surprising, since Cheb is in Bohemia. It's an old fortress town that guards the western approaches. Good for us, in this instance, since the garrison is a mercenary company and its commander has been well bribed. We abandoned these wagons in Cheb and replaced them with several smaller ones, much better designed for travel in the mountains. We even have a cavalry escort while we pass down part of the Bohemian forest until we re-enter the USE near Kutsting. There we will follow the Regen down to Regensburg, where we will exchange the wagons. That has also been arranged for a barge that will take us down the Danube into Austria."
He'd already explained this to the leaders of the Uptimers, the older Barclays and O'Connor and his son. But it seemed they either hadn't paid attention or hadn't considered all the implications.
"Hey, wait a minute," said Alan O'Connor. "We're coming back into the USE? What the hell for? I know my geography, damn it. Once we're across into Bohemia, let's just stay there until we get to Austria."
Janos stared at him.
"Indeed. As a geographical proposition, that is certainly feasible. Follow the rivers down to Pulzen. From there, we could take a good road to České Budějovice, the largest town in southern Bohemia. From there, of course, it is a short distance to Austria, and along a very good road, given the long and constant intercourse between Vienna and Prague."
O'Connor nodded.
"Yeah, that's what I was thinking."
No rabbit had ever been this stupid for a certainty.
"You have missed the news, then, of the war between Bohemia and Austria, which has been going on for a year and a half now."
The Uptimers frowned at him. They looked like a pack of confused rabbits, all except Susie Barclay, who just looked like a crazed rabbit. Janos grit his teeth, reminding himself that he needed to remain on the best possible terms with these people.
"Not a good idea," he said thinly. "The reason I could bribe the commander of the Cheb garrison is because no one expects hostilities to erupt between the USE and Bohemia. So that frontier post was given to a man who was competent enough, but needed no further qualifications, such as what you might call a rigorous sense of duty. At Pulzen in České Budějovice, on the other hand, we would be dealing with Pappenheim's black cuirassiers."
The Uptimers seemed to draw back a little.
"Ah, I see you have heard of them. Yes, we do not wish to have dealings with the black cuirassiers."
Enough. Still more time had been wasted. He pointed stiffly to the broken wagon.
"So let us begin unloading it, now. And discard from the other two wagons whatever is not essential."
Chapter 6. The Mess. High Street Mansion, seat of government for the state of Thuringia Franconia. President's Office, Grantville, state of Thuringia Franconia. After Grantville's police chief finished his report, Ed Piazza, president of the state of Thuringia Franconia, half turned his swivel chair and looked out of the window in his office. That was the first time he'd so much as glanced outside since he showed up for work this morning. His schedule had been jam-packed even before this latest crisis hit. The weather was still good, he saw, clear with not a cloud in the sky. Very crisp, of course, in the way such days in November were, but not yet bitterly cold the way it would become in January and February. Well, not crisis exactly, he mused. He and Mike Stearns had long known that there was no way to keep the USE's enemies from getting their hands on American technical knowledge, nor from suborning some of the Americans themselves. Among the 3,500 people who'd come from uptime through the Ring of Fire, there was bound to be the usual percentage who were excessively greedy and not burdened with much in the way of a conscience. That was even leaving aside the ones, there were a lot of those now, who'd accepted legitimate offers to relocate elsewhere. You couldn't keep people from emigrating, after all. Not, at least, without building some sort of godforsaken version of a Berlin Wall, which neither he nor Mike had wanted any part of. Some people were surprised, even astonished, at the number of Americans who were leaving Grantville these days. They'd assumed that long familiarity, habits, family ties, not to mention modern indoor plumbing, would keep almost everyone from straying. But that was unrealistic. West Virginians, especially northern West Virginians, had been accustomed to moving around a lot, since the area was economically depressed except when the mines were working full bore. Most families had at least one person, in the past, who'd moved to one of the industrial cities to make a living. Often they came back when things at home picked up, but sometimes they didn't. And those had been relocations just to get decent-paying but usually hard jobs in a steel mill or auto assembly plant. Today, anyone with skills was being offered salaries that were the downtime equivalent of the kind of money top-drawer technical and business consultants made back uptime. Often enough, with lots of perks and benefits attached. And since the prospective employers were rich, many of them noblemen, sometimes royalty, even the problem of leaving modern plumbing behind wasn't so bad. It wasn't as if the upper classes of the 17th century were medieval barons living in stone piles, after all. They had indoor plumbing, however rudimentary it might be by late 20th century American standards. And it would get better quickly, too, since the people offering the jobs had a keen desire themselves to get better facilities. Anyone in Grantville who had significant plumbing skills and experience practically had a carte blanche to go anywhere in Europe. To add pressure to pull, most uptimers after the Ring of Fire had lost what they'd had in the way of a safety net back uptime, which, for working-class people like most of the town's inhabitants, had never been all that munificent in the first place. Social Security was gone. Company pensions were gone, except for a few companies headquartered in Grantville who'd been able to maintain them. Medicare was gone. That might not directly affect young people right away, but most people in Grantville were part of families, often extended families. They had parents and grandparents and other elderly relatives who were in a tight situation, sometimes a desperate one. And now, Baron Hoosit or Merchant Moneybags or City Patrician What's-His-Name was waving a small fortune under their noses if they'd just relocate to wherever and apply their skills. So since the end of the Baltic War, the decision to move the SOTF's capital to Bamberg had been a prod, too. A great migration was underway. Great, at least in per capita terms, if not absolute numbers. Some people were even starting to call it the American diaspora. What had been a trickle in the first 3 years after the Ring of Fire was now a small flood. By the time it was over, Ed wouldn't be surprised if half of Grantville's residents wound up living somewhere else, at least for a time. Most of them were staying in the USE, true enough, but the number who were accepting positions in other countries was not inconsiderable, especially countries that had good relations with the USE, like Bohemia, Venice, the Netherlands, and the Scandinavian nations, now united within the Union of Kalmar. Some had gone to France and Austria, a few even farther afield, to Eastern Europe, Russia, Spain, and Portugal, southern Italy, even the New World. In fact, Ed was a little puzzled by the fact this batch of emigrants had chosen to break the law by stealing things that didn't belong to them. Why? There was no legal barrier, as such, to moving to Austria, if that's where they went. The Sanderlands and Sonny Fortney had moved to Vienna not long ago, perfectly, openly, and above board. They'd even hauled two complete automobiles with them. Carol Unruh's suspicion, which she'd voiced 2 days earlier, was that at least some of them were going to wind up implicated in the legal fallout from the Bolander arrest. She'd probably turn out to be right. But whatever the reason, the immediate effect, and the thing that made it a problem for Ed was that it transformed what would have otherwise been a simple emigration into defection and even treason. What a stupid mess. The worst thing about this episode with the Barclays and the O'Connors, assuming for the moment that they got away with it, wasn't actually the tech transfer itself. True, among the whole group of them, they had quite a bit of technical knowledge and skills, not to mention the stuff they'd taken or stolen. But it was hardly as if there was any one secret that was equivalent to a magic wand. One of the USE's enemies, probably Austria, would get a major boost to whatever modernization program they'd set underway. That was hardly enough by itself to transform them overnight into an industrial powerhouse, which was something of a double-edged sword in any event for Europe's royal houses and aristocracy. No, insofar as the affair constituted a crisis, it was a political one, not a military or technical one. Among the still murky set of possible outcomes, one outcome was a certainty. Wilhelm Wettin and his Crown Loyalist Party would pull out the stops to make as much political hay out of it as they could. Wilhelm himself would keep within the limits of using the episode to argue that it showed Americans were nothing special. So what difference did it make if Mike Stern's party had the support of most of them? A large number of the Crown Loyalists would go a lot farther than that, though, arguing that the whole affair cast suspicion on American loyalty in general. And there were some elements within the CLs who'd take it to the hoop. It was well known that reactionary elements were infiltrating that loosely defined and none too disciplined party, now that nationwide elections would be taking place within a few months. Some of them were outright extremists. They'd trot out their usual anti-Catholic diatribes, of course, given the high percentage of Catholics in the defecting group, even if most of them were lapsed Catholics. They'd probably also fire up the anti-Semitic propaganda, ignoring the fact that none of the defectors were Jewish or had any connection to Jews beyond purely casual ones. Logic was hardly the strong suit of that particular current within the politics of the Germanies. Ed managed a chuckle then, remembering one woodcut illustration of himself in a pamphlet put out by one of the reactionary outfits. The Knights of Barbarossa, if he remembered right. The thing had been quite charming in its own way. The horns and the cloven hoofs and the forked tail were standard fare, generic, really. But he'd thought the addition of a grotesquely Jewish hooked nose was a nice touch, given his rather pug-like features. Not to mention showing him sacrificing a presumably Gentile baby in some sort of religious rite, and never mind that he and his wife were lifelong Catholics and attended Mass regularly. He swiveled the chair back to face Preston Richards and Carol Unruh, the other two people in the room. "What if Noelle's right, Press? And have we gotten any word from her since she left?"
"Nothing," said Carol Unruh, answering his second question. "Not a peep. We don't know where she is, really, except somewhere south of Rudolstadt."
The police chief grunted. "She hadn't passed through Saalfeld, or if she did, she didn't stop for anything. We're in radio contact with the authorities there." His expression grew sour. "Not that it's likely to do any good. The garrisons in all the towns in the area are small and entirely mercenary since..." Ed waved that aside. "Yeah, Press, I know, since the Emperor is keeping most of the regular army units in the north because he wants them in position to attack Saxony and Brandenburg in a few months, and he's sending the ones he can spare down to reinforce the troops facing Bavaria and Bernhardt. So, we make do with what we can get. No point pissing and moaning about it all over again. I take it they haven't gotten off their butts and started scouring the countryside."
"Scouring?" Carol jeered. "Their idea of scouring the countryside is trotting a few miles out of town to the nearest watering hole, getting plastered, and reporting that they saw no signs of suspicious activity or suspicious persons passing through. 2 or 3 days' worth of getting soused later."
Her expression grew more solemn.
"I'm mostly worried about Noelle, Ed. She could get hurt or even killed. I mean, you know what she's like." Indeed, he did, having read the detailed report of her activities the previous summer and fall in Franconia during the Ram Rebellion. Ed's wife Annabelle had once described Noel Murphy, now Noel Stull, as Grantville's distaff version of Clark Kent absent the glasses. Primly mannered, maybe I'll become a nun young woman, zips into the phone booth, out comes Super Ingenue. She'd even blown a torturer's head half off when he attacked her partner, Eddie Junker. Since Noel couldn't shoot straight, she'd done so by the simple method of shoving the barrel of the gun under his chin and pulling the trigger. Timid, she was not. Appearances to the contrary.
"We'll just have to hope for the best," he said. Captain Neffler took practically the whole garrison with him up to Hala. "That just leaves the police force, which is under strength to begin with, the way Grantville keeps growing."
Richards gave Carol an apologetic glance.
"I did send a couple of officers over to Rudolstadt, and they were able to get the garrison commander there to detach three of his soldiers to accompany them. No more than three men, though, and no farther south than Hof, without the count's okay. I radioed Magdeburg to see if I could reach him, but it seems Ludwig Gunther and his wife are out of the city visiting relatives at the moment."
That was too bad. The Count of Schwarzburg-Rudolstadt was a capable and conscientious man, and maintained good relations with Grantville. If he or his wife, Emily, had been in residence at their castle in Rudolstadt, they'd have sent out the whole garrison to search for Noel and Eddie, and the defectors too, if Noel was right and they were in the vicinity. It wasn't a big garrison, but it was a good one. Mercenaries, true, but a well-trained and disciplined company that had been in the service of the Count for a long time. Not a contractor's slapdash outfit. The problem was that the state of Thuringia Franconia, at least the area around Grantville, simply didn't have much any longer in the way of military forces. In the months after the Croat raid on Grantville and its high school, more than 2 years earlier, the town had fairly bristled for a while with cavalry patrols, freshly built fortifications, sentinel outposts, the works. But 2 years was a long time in the war conditions of Europe. Soon enough, it became obvious that there was no immediate military threat to Grantville any longer. The key development had been Wallenstein switching sides in 1633. The same man who'd launched the Croat raid was now allied with the USE, and given the number of Americans living in Prague today, some of them very closely connected to the new king, there was simply no way Wallenstein could organize and launch a secret attack, even if he wanted to. So that ended the threat from Bohemia, which was the most pressing one. Who else could launch a raid on Grantville? The Austrians would have to fight their way through Bohemia first, and Wallenstein had beaten their army at the Second Battle of the White Mountain. The Bavarians were in no position to do anything more than try to hold their ground. That had been obvious even before Gustav Adolf's general Bonner seized their fortress of Ingolstadt, which left the Bavarians without a bridgehead north of the Danube. The Saxons were the only real possibility, and that was negligible. John George, the elector, had a full-scale invasion coming, and he knew it perfectly well. He was concentrating entirely on readying Saxony's defenses, not wasting energy on raids that would simply chew up his army. Polk's mercenary forces were really the only ones he had available for something like that anyway. Polk would have to fight his way through sizable forces, USE regulars, too, stationed in Hala, in order to reach Grantville or any of the towns in the Thuringian Basin. Nobody thought he could manage that, and if he even tried, he'd leave Saxony's frontier with Bohemia open to an attack by Wallenstein. There was no way the Elector of Saxony would countenance such a thing. He'd hired Hulk and his army in the first place, despite their unsavory reputation, in order to help protect his southern flank. Who else? A few hysterics shrieked about the French menace, pointing with alarm to Turenne's daring raid on the Vitsa oil fields during the Baltic War, but that was downright laughable. Given the political tensions in France after the war, there was no way Richelieu was going to send his best general herring off on a long-distance raid. Even if he did, so what? Only somebody who was geographically challenged and completely ignorant of logistics could possibly think that a raid from France to Grantville was anything like a raid into Brunswick. That Turenne was an exceptionally gifted military commander had been proven in this universe, as well as being attested to by the historical records of another. That did not make him a magician who could fight his way through the entire USE. It was 300 miles from the French frontier to Grantville, even as the crow flies, at least half again that far the way an army would have to travel. No, aside from the mundane and everyday risks of living in a boomtown, Grantville was about as safe as any place in Europe these days. So, beginning in the fall of 1633, the military forces that had once protected it carefully had been almost completely drained away. They were needed elsewhere. The regular cavalry patrols were a thing of the past, the sentinel posts had been abandoned completely, and the outlying fortresses had no more than a handful of men detached from the small garrisons maintained in the towns of the basin, who were really there to keep order and double as a police force, more than to serve as an actual military defense. "We haven't got a pot to piss in, is what it amounts to," he said.
"Not for something like this, Mr. President," agreed the police chief.
Carol looked fierce.
"If those bastards so much as hurt Noel and Eddie, I don't care what Mike says. I'm for firing up the war against Austria, or whoever it is."
There'd be a lot of that sentiment, Ed knew, if Noel and Eddie came to harm. Granted, assuming Austria was behind the affair, most people would hold a grudge about the mass defection in any event. But most of the grudge would be aimed at the defectors themselves, not the Austrians. It wouldn't be the sort of thing that would set off any real war fever. Noel and Eddie getting killed or badly injured would be a different kettle of fish altogether. Ed contemplated the problem for a few seconds. As a practical proposition, of course, launching any sort of immediate campaign against Austria was a non-starter. But immediate meant next year. The year after that? He shook his head slightly. That was pointless speculation right now. They still didn't even know what was really happening.
"I guess that's it, then, for the moment."
He straightened up in his chair. "Unless Denise Beasley, there's a real pip for you, shows up with some more information." Press Richards grinned.
"Don't think that's too likely. I got no idea what she's up to now. The last I saw her, she was racing off on her bike giving me and Neffler the finger. Most of her spleen wasn't really aimed at me, since Denise knows I haven't got the resources to do what she wanted. But she probably has me lumped in with the fathead for the time being."
Carol's mouth made a little O.
"Did she really call Captain Neffler a fathead? I mean, to his face?"
"Oh, yeah." Solemnly, Press shook his head. "Wasn't all she called him, I'm deeply sorry to report. Girl's got a real potty mouth when she cuts it loose. She also called him a fuckwad and an asshole and a motherfucking moron."
"She's not even 16.
"She's Buster's kid," Ed grunted. "That's got to add a decade or so, at least in the lack of respect for your betters department. Thank God I'm no longer the high school principal. She's not my headache these days." Richards and Unruh both looked at him.
"Well, she isn't," Ed insisted,
hoping it was true.
Chapter 7. The Wild Blue Yonder. Kelly Aviation Facility, near Grantville, State of Thuringia, Franconia. Denise stared at the object that was the center of the proposal Lanny had just advanced.
"No fucking way," she pronounced.
Yost shook his head lugubriously.
"You really ought to watch your... Don't fucking start on me, Lanny. Just don't."
She pointed an accusing finger at the aircraft.
"There is no fucking, or fliberty jerking, if that makes you happier, way in hell I'm getting into that thing."
Lanny frowned.
"What does fliberty jerking mean?
And what's the matter, anyway? It flies. It flies just fine. I've taken it up plenty of times."
After a 2-second pause, he added,
"Well,
Maybe 3 times.
Denise scowled at him.
You said yourself, it's a prototype, remember?
Well, sure, but he let that trail off into nothing. The truth was, except for being a boozer, Lanny wasn't a bad guy. And he did have the virtue of being a very loyal sort of person, even if Denise thought he had to be happy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.